And good morning and good evening to everybody today, and welcome to today's webinar with a bunch of stage managers. My name is Anna Robb, and I'm the co-founder and managing director of TheatreArtLife, and I'm thanking my team who I used to work with in Macau to come together to talk about stage management teams today. Before we get started, I have a couple of housekeeping things to go through, and then we'll introduce everybody here and get chatting about what we'd like to chat about. So let me talk about today. So if you've never used Webinar Jam before, there's a chat box on the right there, and you can click on that and ask any questions that you like as we go along. And if there's anything that, you know, from any one of us that you need to know, whatever, just throw it in there and we'll moderate as we go along and answer all those questions. If there's any reasons that you drop out, don't worry about it. You can log back in anytime via the email link that was sent. And sometimes that happens from depending on your internet connection. Sometimes also if you can't hear us, you can log back out, log back in again, and that generally fixes the situation. So, and if you do have spotty internet and you can't see us all the time, don't worry, a replay will be available and it'll get sent to your email 24 hours, probably even less than 24 hours after this session. And it's available for 5 days, so you can, you know, listen to us banter on about things. before I go back to a little bit of context of the show that we all worked on together, I'd like all of my team to introduce themselves and where they are currently now.
Yes.
What they were working on before COVID-19 shut us down, and then we'll go and talk about the show that we worked together on in Macau, China. So, Dean, do you want to start?
Hey.
Can't hear you, Dean. Okay, we'll start with Nathan then.
Right. Technically, right. Hello, everyone.
Dave, you might need to log out and log back in again.
Really glad to be here with the old gang to talk about our experience in Macau, and happy to share my perspective on that as well. Currently, I'm tuning in from Chicago in the US. Before being here, I was I'm the general stage manager on Cirque du Soleil's big top touring show, Cusa. And before that, we were playing in Seville for a couple of months, January and February. We were planning to transfer to more European countries, but that's on hiatus now until till conditions clear up, when they do. Yeah.
Good, thank you. Mads, Rex, can you just mute, because the people are saying they can hear you, kids. All right, go, Mads.
Just making sure you can hear me.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Excellent. So my name is Madison Burkett. I'm currently on the Gold Coast in Australia. I was most recently working on the international tour of School of Rock, the musical. We did 18 months through Australia, New Zealand, and China. And then I was meant to be next working on 9 to 5, the musical, in Australia as well, which has also been put on hiatus. But I come from House of Dancing Water originally as well, spent a little bit of time at La Rev in Las Vegas before kind of transitioning back to Australia and more into the music theatre side.
Great, thank you. Dean, can we hear you?
Test, test. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can. We can. All right. Introduce yourself.
Okay, good. Working now. So I'm Dean Jewell. I'm the general stage manager on Lusia for Cirque du Soleil. We're currently on layoff, as all of Cirque du Soleil is. I just took the show to Moscow. We set up there for a few days. Once the show was actually all bumped into Moscow and all our artists arrived, the decision was made to cancel. We packed up. We sent everybody home. Bit of a scramble for a week, but I'm back in Toronto and very happy to be back at home. Lucky to get back in when we did. The borders were closing very quickly around everybody, and it was quite a tense time to get back out of Moscow and into back into Canada. So back in Canada now, enjoying the cool weather again, and yeah, waiting for the next installment, really, after this whole thing passes.
Fantastic. So Rex, sorry, you want to say anything else, Dean?
I was going to say, I ended up at House of Dancing Water after doing Cats in Australia, through a friend of mine, and and then after Dancing Water in Macau, I ended up on touring through America. So.
Thanks, Dean. And Rex, go for it.
I'm the one with kids in the background. I'm really sorry. My babysitter hasn't shown up, but hopefully they'll be here soon. After my time in what I'm currently working on is I've just joined the Harry Potter and the Cursed Child company in Australia. So I've just moved to Melbourne. I did about 3 weeks before we were shut down as well. Obviously, we plan to reopen because we're a resident show. Just the time frame on that is hugely unknown right now. We're cancelled through to the 31st of May. So that's where we stand at the moment. After Macau, I worked for a company called Artur, which is a company that looks after regional Queensland, predominantly regional Queensland performing arts touring. We also do some national touring. But I decided a 9-to-5 job doesn't quite suit me, and I headed back to shows with Harry Potter, so which is really exciting. It's a great company, great people, a huge show call, and a lot of fun to learn. So.
Great, cool. And I'm currently in Australia as well, bunkering down during COVID-19, but I'm usually based in Hong Kong. I freelance as a producer or a show caller, stage manager. I just do whatever I can around Asia and the Middle East. And I have worked with all of these people who you're looking at now. We all worked in Macau for at least 3.5 years on the show that we're about to talk about. So there's a lot of time, effort and love and squabbles between us, I think, that we've had over our years there together. So before we get started to talk about the actual team and how we worked, I think it's best that we give a little bit of context of, you know, where Macau is the context of the show. Okay, so let me go back to the slides. So Macau, if you're not aware, is on the bottom corner of China, next to Hong Kong, so you can see there on the big map. I had to look it up the first time that I got interviewed for the job as well, because I had no idea where it was. And a little zoom in here, you can see it's about 7 miles long and 7 miles wide, sort of island. It's a special administrative region, so it's not exactly essentially China. It has more freedoms and rights than China, a little bit like Hong Kong. And Hong Kong and Macau are still separate states, so like you still separate countries, so you still need a visa to go between the two, and you still need a visa to go into China. You can get to Hong Kong via a ferry. Now you can get via a bridge, but originally it was just a ferry and an hour ferry across the water. Now you can jump on a bridge and drive across there for about 40 minutes. And that's where it is. And it's kind of known as the Asian Las Vegas. It's got a lot of casinos in it. There's a lot of gambling. It takes in more revenue than Las Vegas in terms of gambling. There's a lot of people, mainland Chinese, that come across the border to spend money there, spend weekends there. It has a huge Portuguese history because it was once owned, it was once a Portuguese colony. So it's like Hong Kong is a mix of British and China. Macau is a mix of Portuguese and Chinese, and so the sort of political system and the way things are run is a balance between those kind of cultures. And you can see some of those Portuguese style buildings around Macau very frequently, then balanced out with a bunch of casinos across the place. This is the City of Dreams, which is the casino that all of these people in these little boxes know very, 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 very well. This is our home, our life for a very long period of time. It's a bunch of hotels that conform into a casino area, and the back of that space is the theatre that we worked in. The theatre that we worked in is called the House of Dancing Water Theatre. It's just under 2,000 seats. Sort of a 180, a little bit over 180, almost 360 degrees stage. It's an aquatic show, 144 winches in the grid, only 125 were used, but that's another story. And that's the theatre. The show is still running today. It opened in 2010, and it's its 10-year anniversary this September. And myself, Dean and Rex were involved in the creation period, and Nathan and Madison joined around 3 years into the running of the show. So we're going to talk a little bit about how the show was created, but then also dig into the operations and the stage management team on a day-to-day basis, because it's quite a large team, yeah? I'm going to skip here and show you a very 30-second video of the trailer of the show so that you can understand the scale and scope of what we were dealing with. Here we go.
City of Dreams Macau presents the House of Dancing Water, a $2 billion Hong Kong dollar production. Created and directed by Franco Dragon. A show like no other on earth. The House of Dancing Water. Now showing at City of Dreams Macau. Get your tickets now.
So there you go. That was the trailer. And before we go now. It's a very old video, but I couldn't find any more recent. They need to do another update of it. Just one before we get started chatting, I think it's worth just talking about the stage management structure. Oh, you can't probably see the bottom there because our cameras are over it. But it was an 8 to 9 person team for most of the show. I think it's really, I have to point out that this is kind of the structure that it was when I left, but there's been many iterations of how the stage management team existed there. It changed quite regularly due to, people coming and going, what was needed at the time, the growth and the development of the show. But roughly there was a general stage manager, which was myself, senior stage manager, lead stage manager, 3 stage managers, and then 2 assistant stage managers. And often we had a lot of a rolling extra person. We ended always having 9 in the department for some reason. I don't know how we managed that, but it was always a good thing. Just to keep the knowledge and the base there. So that's really a little bit of context. And if you have any questions about that, then you can get throw them into the chat box. And Gerardo says, is it kind of like Loreb in Vegas? It is. Mads, do you want to just talk about maybe the comparisons between House of Dancing Water and Loreb in Vegas, just for
For context? So Loreb and House were both directed by Franco Dragone, so they're both that type of water show. Loreb opened in 2005, so it's about 5 years older than House of Dancing Water, and it's similar in a lot of ways, but on kind of a smaller, more intimate scale. Mm-hmm. It's completely 360, so it's all the way around, and it still has the lifts that go up and down, but like probably, you know, a third of the stage size of what House is. But there's definitely similar elements. The choreographer was the same. The musical composer was the same. So a lot of the there's lots of similar elements between the two shows, but just on a slight Loreb slightly on a more smaller intimate scale.
Mm-hmm. Great, thanks, Mads. So, and save me just talking too much because I've started a lot. Dean or Rex, do you want to talk a little bit about the creation process of this show?
Sure.
Ooh.
Oh, Rex is
going to wait. Dean, you can start.
Sure. Well, I started on the show in Belgium, of all places. We did a training and formation, which lasted, I think it was 18 months in total, Anna, if that's right. I came in, I think, for the last 4 or 5 months of that process, maybe 6 months. We ended up getting a little delayed in the training and formation in Belgium due to, the delays of the venue. There was a lot of building delays, building the whole theatre from scratch. And the whole resort from scratch as well. So there was a lot of delays there, construction delays mainly, which kept putting us back. We kept getting held in Macau, which meant that when we got to Macau, we had an arsenal of acts up our sleeves. Franco wasn't that involved with that training and formation process. He'd come out once every 6 months or so. But the choreographer and his 2 assistants and, Anna and the team there, we put together a whole bunch of acts, a whole bunch of aerial acts, which translated directly into the show in the long run. But basically the way Franco liked to work, and the reason I think that the show is so amazing, is because we had so many things that he could draw from during his creation process in the theatre itself. Literally, he would just throw a couple of people on stage and go, you two, 6 months ago, a year ago, I saw you two do an act. It was a pas de deux, do it again for me. And they'd do it again. And then the whole company would be invited to the stage to also do that pas de deux on stage. But the reason that the show has so much content, and the reason it's so polished, if you like, is that all of that content was so polished when they brought it from training and formation into creation and brought it into the theatre. So it was a really interesting way of working. Everything was built in small little pastiches in Belgium and then taken in no particular order in a big bag of tricks to Macau and reassembled in the order that Franco wanted to put the show together in. A really fascinating way of working, really. Mm-hmm. But yeah, training and formation was fascinating. It was an amazing time for the company. It did go on a little too long, and people started to, you know, wonder if we were ever going to go to Macau. We kind of had a joke that we were all in the Truman Show or a movie like that, but in fact they were filming a documentary about this whole process as well. So we weren't convinced for a while that there even was a Macau or a theatre being built in Macau. We were just part of some giant sort of experiment to get a bunch of gymnasts together in a venue and see what happens.
It would have been a good social experiment to film that, I'm sure.
Yeah. That was a great time. Training and formation was a really open, caring, sharing experience. Everyone had a voice, everyone had input, everyone had their job to do, and it worked really, really, really nicely. It was a nice time. Then we got to Macau and saw the reality of the venue, which was just blew our minds. I mean, it was such a huge beast to see for the first time, such an enormous machine, basically a 15-story machine that, the audience is kind of in the middle of that, or on like the fourth to fifth story of that, if you like. There's four more stories underground and then nine more stories above them. So it's an absolute huge thing. And everything that opens and shuts and moves and all of the machinery that in there is quite an amazing thing. So marrying the two of those together is, that's what the creation process is all about. It's about using the technical, making nice looking staging, making interesting looking transitions, and then putting these acts that we already had kind of up our sleeves and seeing where they fit in that whole process. That's my take of it. And being fired.
There's a number
as well.
Yeah, we're getting fired every day because there's a number of questions on the structure of the team, lead SMs and production stage manager GSM. We'll answer those in a second because I think it is important to talk about the context of what those roles were and how they sat in it. But before we do that, Rex, do you want to just talk about your perception of the creation process?
It's funny because when we hit the end of creation, we actually opened the show. I was like, okay, I never want to do that again. Like it was such a full on experience for such a long time. But even just 2 months after that, I was like, I would happily build another show in that same process again. I think one of the most incredible things about the whole process was, yes, the show came from training and formation in Belgium to Macau, with sort of three quarter 75% developed acts and a ton of choreography and, a really strong knowledge of what the technical systems could do. So there's some very heaps and heaps of different cues written for the aerial grid to show what the winches could do in real time in the space, things like that, which made it a really interesting process for then the next step. But Franco very quickly realised that a lot of what had been developed was in a way too small for the cavernous space that was. It's essentially like the inside of a red lantern. That's the design of the theatre. And some other shows hadn't used their cavernous space so well and the show got a bit lost. So very quickly through the creation process, he realised that we needed to sort of expand what was already in existence. Like, I believe the Strapsack Dana was originally a five-winch act from the training and formation process, but it became a seven-person act to actually fill the space more. The bungee act started as four people on the pagode. Throughout that creation process was added in the Stinger Girls on the outside and then the boys up in north, which actually just sort of used the space more effectively to make sure that the audience could actually, the audience right up the back in those very north corners could still experience something in a similar way to the people in the south in the VIP section. So that was a really incredible process to watch that come together. Very, very aware of the space as a whole and not just focusing it towards the south, towards the VIP section. And just seeing how quickly Franco would go, okay, that's not working. This isn't working, let's move on, let's try this. And people had been working for so long on different elements but were able to just go, okay, and let's move on. Like people weren't particularly, people didn't get too attached to something. Some people did. But they were able to go, okay, well, it's time to move on and let's look at something different. Let's make sure, let's work on something different together. But because you had so much there, there was always something you could then go to, which made it a far smoother process.
Yeah, yeah. So before, I don't want to exclude Nathan and Mads too because I don't want to go too much on creation, but we can go back to ask those questions. I'll talk a little bit about somebody asked about the role of production stage manager and general stage manager. Just as a preface to this, this is a big discussion that I've had with Matthew Stern and Gareth Hulance and a lot of other stage managers as we've had an international stage management discussion. And in a global sense, there's not really particular rules to follow. The way that it worked for us, and particularly, I guess, for me, because I was the production stage manager on the show and then transitioned into the general stage manager for the show. So what's the difference? Well, the production stage manager was there. I created an artistic breakdown. I created a technical breakdown. I was there putting all of the cues together with my with the technical teams. I created the prompt script and then with my team with Dean and Rex and a bunch of others, we were doing the scheduling and facilitating what trainings needed to happen, what rehearsals needed to happen and get the show mounted. When you move into the general stage management position, is there more into the management side of it. So, hi Gareth, I just saw you come in. Management side of it. So you're managing the stage management team, you're training the show callers and you're focusing on building what we used to call standard operating procedures. So what do we do in this situation? What do we do in emergencies? What do we do in show stops? What do we do in these sort of things? So it's a very different role. They're quite the same skill sets, but they're very, very different roles because in a production stage management, you're mounting a show and your focus is on making the best show possible. And then when you're a general stage manager, you're about maintaining the best show possible. And so that's kind of the balance. We didn't start with lead stage managers or senior stage managers, did we? We started really with me and then a bunch of stage managers and ASMs. But the reality was is that it was too big a show for me to manage alone. I needed to share that responsibility with a number of other people so that it wasn't just sitting in my brain or coming out of my, you know, paperwork. It needed to be handed over. So we created the role of senior stage manager and lead stage manager to handle certain aspects of the show. Another person asked what was the difference between a lead stage manager and the stage manager. Not much, really. In fact, it was just more that maybe the lead stage manager led more trainings or they led more things in the show call aspect of it. The lead stage manager, you know, further on into the operations when Nathan and Mads are in there and everything like that, I as a show caller would only call once a week just to keep in the routine. But the majority of that show calling would be held by the stage managers and the lead stage manager rather than that, because there was a lot of management on a show like that with 90 something artists and, you know, 130 crew, and that just became a thing that needed to be managed over show calling the show. So that's how it kind of evolved for us. So I guess, Mad, Nathan, do you want to talk a little bit about when you came into the show and your perceptions and the operation, and we get the, like, we can go back to creation for questions, but let's dig into us as a team 3 years in.
Yeah, so I came in originally to do my internship the end of 2012, and then I kind of went away, was doing my own thing, and then I was actually in New York and I reached out to Anna and just said to her, look, like, if a job ever does become available as an ASM, then I'm definitely still interested. And so I think about a week later she contacted me and was like, we actually need someone to be here in like 3 weeks' time. And I think I was like, oh, I've just got my American visa. I'm just like getting started in New York, but okay. And so I ended up moving to Macau permanently in March 2013. And then I was there until May-ish 2016. So quite a while in the end, not what I really thought at the beginning. But yeah, so it was kind of interesting to come in that kind of period in. And I'd been fortunate because at least I'd done my internship, so I had an understanding of what the show was and what the structure of the team was. But a lot of the people at that point were a lot of still the original people. So it was very confronting to come in at the start and kind of look at this show and go, oh my, there's no way that I'm never ever going to understand everything that's going on here. I remember sitting in some of the original stage management meetings when I was there and listening to whole conversations and being like, I don't understand any of the words that they're saying. I know it's English. I don't know what any of it is in reference to. And I think it was a little while later that I was like, oh, okay, like I get it now. I understand what they're talking about. But it definitely was very confronting at the very start, but then also like really exciting. I'd never seen anything like this show. I think I'd known Anna previously and I had seen some footage of the show very early on, and I think like the show had just opened and I was already like messaging Anna like a year and a half in advance being like, I want to come and do my internship on this show. She's like, I don't think HR are even prepared to like work out how to deal with that yet, but sure. So that was kind of how I ended up there.
I had a pretty similar experience in the fact that I reached out to Anna as well, maybe like a year and a half at least before having the opportunity to go there. But before being in Macau, I was mostly working on really mostly like small music gigs, music festivals, some various like production work for radio and TV. So, but I always kind of wanted to do more in theatre and have like a little passion for circus as well that wasn't fully realized. So going to Macau, I originally had the intention just to go over there for 3 months. I was hired on a 3-month contract as an assistant stage manager. And getting there was I wouldn't say traumatizing, but it definitely was in some way like a slap in the face. Just the sheer size and scale of that venue is nothing I'd ever seen in Australia. The show content as well was completely alien to me, and even the structure of the stage management team, having so many people in a stage management department where I'd been used to either 1- and 2-person teams on smaller gigs just around New South Wales. So it was kind of a very, very different experience for me. But that 3 years turned into 4 or 5 just because it was awesome. It was great.
I don't think anyone ever goes to Macau planning to stay past 2 years. And I'm pretty sure everybody goes to Macau and ends up staying past 2 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess that's probably a good question, you know, and some people have asked me that in the past, you know, what keeps you there for that period of time? And I'll answer the question from my sense of thing is, like, there were so many challenges associated with the show, show stops and contingencies and managing a complex team. I mean, when you're managing a team of stage managers, they're all leaders, right? And so, like, managing a group of leaders is an extremely challenging, I love you all, but it's a challenging situation to do because everybody's got opinions and everybody's there and you want to give everybody the space to contribute. And then that's when we started to really delineate tasks and have some autonomy. So there's a couple of things that, you know, I really handed off to these guys in terms of how the schedule was being managed, how the lineup was being handled. And then they would then own those projects and report back rather than me being the manager of all of that. All of that aspect, simply because it was too much for one person to do. So, I mean, what you mentioned a little bit, Mads, you know, coming into the team and being a little bit overwhelming, but like, can you elaborate on that in terms of how you felt you fitted in or didn't fit in?
Yeah, I mean, I had come from basically straight from theatre school to Macau, and everything that I had done at theatre school like couldn't in any way possibly prepare me for this show because of the way because as Nathan said, because of how big the team is, how big the show is, it was kind of very confronting at the beginning. But I think the good thing is that like anyone who's worked on the show or anyone who was there was kind of very aware of that. So when you come into the show, the expectations of what you're required to do, especially like as an ASM, is quite low. You know, it's very much like just learn the basics. You know, it's you have like kind of your daily tasks of keeping the show running. You're running a track backstage every show. You kind of only expected to really learn, like, you know, we have 5 backstage tracks, but you're only expected to learn like one at a time, learn it, sit on it for a while, really get it to sink into your head, and then kind of move on. So the process of actually integrating as part of the team is like has been very well thought out, especially by the stage that we got there of how to slowly integrate into that position. And I think that was definitely one of the things that kept me there. I was, you know, I started as an ASM, and by the time I left the show in my time, I was the senior stage manager, and I worked my way up to being able to call the show, which is not something that necessarily everyone in the team gets to do, because you don't need that many people to call the show. So I think being able to continually learn new things, learn new roles, interact in different ways with the cast and with the crew is what really inspired me to want to stay for as long as I did. It was something new every single day.
Nathan, you have something to add to that?
Literally never a dull day.
I think all of that stuff is really juicy. Like as soon as you feel challenged, and as soon as you feel like you are all made aware of the potential that other people see in you that you don't necessarily see for yourself based on where you've come from or your work experience or whatever in the past, and kind of having that person to like unlock that door into all of these new possibilities is like all of a sudden there's all this information to feed you and to help you grow. But I think on top of that, something that I really cherish from my time there for sure was as you start to just accrue months and years, and as you start to pick on new processes like the schedule and the lineup and leading trainings, calling trainings only and then calling the show, you start to become a real rock for people that are around you. So a lot of people start coming to you that you may not have spoken to for the first year because they're a bit more sheltered or a bit more quiet or a bit more kind of timid to approach people in kind of that level of stage management or coaching or wherever. So kind of becoming that person for people and kind of being recognized and respected for the knowledge that you have and kind of earning that along the way is something that really motivated me after I left to go back for that 6 months to lead the cast change. So it was kind of having an environment where you're really valued and respected for what you contribute rather than just what you do, I think is a big one too.
And we literally had like an onboarding plan for the stage managers. Like it was like, I don't know how many pages it was, but it was like this is what you do on day one. This is what you do on day two. This is what you do week 3, 4, 5, 6. And it wasn't, you weren't expected to, a lot of stage managers tend to come into a show and expect to hit the ground running. And that's, as everybody knows here, that's really impossible because you don't have the skills or the knowledge about the show to be able to be effective. So there was always this kind of divide. A stage manager would come in and you'd be like, okay, pull the brakes on a little bit. All I want you to do is sit there and learn for the next 6 to 8 weeks, and then you're going to start taking on responsibilities as you've developed that knowledge.
For sure. Yeah. Considering that the environment itself is also really challenging, it's kind of once you're in an international or like kind of weird isolated environment like that for a period of time, you start to notice who's really going to succeed in those environments because of how well they adapt to understanding that they themselves need to take a step back rather than coming in kind of guns blazing, bringing in all of their experience and knowledge, where a lot of that stuff kind of needs to get scrapped and you kind of need to relearn quite a few things, especially jargon and kind of like processes that are kind of bespoke for this particular environment.
A good question we have here is from Xavier. How do you collaborate with crew, et cetera, with possible language barriers? I think we probably greeted that very much so in the beginning. Rex or Dean, do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, we can talk about that.
You go, Dean.
Okay, sure. It's interesting. I mean, we had a lot of different cultural barriers and language barriers when we first started. There was a lot of groups from different countries. We had a Tanzanian group, we had an Ethiopian group, we had a a lot of Polish, a large Polish contingent in the show, a few Chinese. In training formation, we had one Chinese lady who was with us, who didn't come all the way to the actual show with us, just did the training formation period. And there was a few groups like that. We had some a contortionist troupe from Ethiopia, lovely ladies. They didn't make it all the way to Macau either. It wasn't going to work out in Franco's
career. Well, they ran away. Let's be real, they ran
That's
away.
That's right, they ran away. Yeah.
That's another story. One day they were there and the next day they weren't.
That's right. I already went to Macau by that stage. I went to Macau with the Moto Boys. That wasn't my opener. By myself, the only stage manager with a bunch of motorcycle riding crazy boys. That was fun. But during that time, this whole thing kicked off with the Ethiopian girls as well, and they ended up leaving the show. Very strange. Anyway, the language... it was interesting. I remember during training and formation, we had an artistic director who was addressing the company. He speaks very quickly. He's a very, very intelligent man. He talks at 1,000 miles an hour, pulling out all the 50-cent words. And most of our artists would just sit there staring at him like, we have no idea what this man is talking about. So I'd write a little overview of what he'd said in very simple words on a piece of board and hold it up behind him and show the cast, and then they sort of nod and start to understand a little bit more. But certainly from the cast, there was certainly the understanding and expectation that they would learn English and they would speak English, and English would be the language that we would use on the show.
We did provide the lessons too. It's probably important to note. Yeah. The company provided the lessons to those who needed it.
Yeah, we had Brazilians on the show, all sorts of, from all over the world. It was a really interesting group of people, and all struggling at the start with their English. I mean, by the time I got there, most of them had a very good knowledge or understanding of English. But I understand that when they first all came in, some of them didn't speak a word of English, so they had a huge learning curve just to be able to communicate with everybody else on the show as well. So, and once they, I think the company became so strong, the performing company particularly became so strong together because they were all on this journey together. Most of them needed to learn something in order to communicate. So by communicating with each other in their broken English, they really got better at it together as a team, and were really proud of that and became stronger as a team together because of that. On a technical side of things, I mean, once we got to the theater in Macau, it was a pretty Western environment, I have to say. I mean, there was a French and a lot of the language used by Franco and a lot of his conceptors was French. So a lot of the times you're trying to pick up what they're trying to say or what's going to happen next. Certainly as a stage manager on the deck, trying to preempt what Franco wants next. If he's talking in French, it's a little bit more difficult until Anna would chime in and sort of translate as to what Franco actually did want us to achieve down on stage or who he wanted on stage at that time. But language barrier was something that I think theatre and events, in my experience, there's some way that we just overcome that. It doesn't seem to be a big barrier to overcome. It seems quite easy for us to accommodate people's lack of understanding of English. I think we were all very good at our ability to sort of sense when someone doesn't understand you. And then, slow it down, really explain it again a little bit more slowly. And and then get your point across and make sure again that they actually understand what you said, just to make sure that what you think they understand, they actually do understand, because there's a lot to smiling and nodding, but you need to get them to kind of repeat it back to you and make sure they actually understand what you're trying to say, especially when there's so many health and safety implications from all the information they're imparting can have huge health and safety implications, so that they really need to understand exactly what you're saying.
I think there was also the benefit of also being on an aquatic show. Underneath the water, there is no language, right? So there's a lot of gestures and unspoken communication that goes on. Inevitably became a dialogue that we used to communicate. And I remember during creation, I would obviously relay instructions over the microphone, and then I'd be like to maybe a Chinese-speaking artist, do you understand? And he'd tap the top of his head to say, I understand what you're saying to me. And that became a communication, which is an underwater signal for scuba people. But it became an out-of-water communication thing. Yeah, I understand what you're saying. And And especially when you're creating stuff with a lot of automation and people are flying, you can't go into a sequence thinking, does this person understand or not? You know they need to understand. And so you've got to make sure that everybody in that group is on the same page. And a lot of that kind of being done with gestures, common movements we developed together, non-spoken communication, and that's how we circumnavigated some of those physical barriers. And as you, once you get into the actual show, it's also the same thing. I mean, as a show caller, I'm behind a glass wall, I can't speak to them. And it's going to be useless for me to speak to them over a microphone as well in the midst of a show. So we developed a lot of tools to, we had cue lights that meant certain things for performers. We had green lights to tell them that the lifts were at depth. We had music signals to indicate things to the performers so they understood what was happening around them and if there was an issue. And so all of those things evolved as you create the show out of necessity and out of practicality.
Well, and on a very base level in terms of communication, the schedule is color-coded. So for those who couldn't read English, you know, whose reading English wasn't particularly strong, they knew how to read the schedule in terms of look for their color, look for their name, look for, and everybody understood what that schedule meant. We also, through creation, we developed a language about the show, and I think we shared that with technical from the very first day. So everybody started talking the same language when we spoke about acts. And there was a great sign up on the level 8 rigging area for a really long time that was, you want to what? Because all of the, you know, the way Australians talk about tools and equipment, the way Americans and Canadians talk about tools and equipment, everybody has a slightly different language. So they had like a list of, you know, shifters and gaff tape and electrical tape and what every different nationality called it, which was quite cute and an easy way to start a conversation about where our languages were different. For me, I know that when I started addressing the company, when I became senior stage manager and then later artistic manager, the way I spoke changed because I had to drop out all of the Australian slang because you just knew that the Tanzanians wouldn't understand you, the Polish, a lot of people would just not understand that slang and also just didn't understand the Australian sarcasm. You know, it really changed how I spoke and how I communicated when I'm talking to a group of people who I don't necessarily share a language with. And I must say I have a huge amount of respect for anyone who does speak fluently more than one language because I don't. So if they're speaking to me in broken English, it's because they're fluent in another language and I have a huge amount of respect for anyone who can speak several languages. So it was a great, it was an incredible learning process for us as well.
A question from Ethan is, what did SMs who aren't doing calling do during the show? So there's 8 in the team generally, and it takes 6 people to run the show. So there's 1 show caller and 5 stage managers backstage. So that's 6. And then the other 2 would either be doing administrative work in the office and or hopefully sometimes we'd, towards the end of my time there, we could rotate people off and people have an early finish. So, and keep people to a decent 42-hour week rather than, you know, the 60 to 80-hour weeks we were pulling when we first started the show, dealing with all of the things that could go wrong. So generally we're pretty busy day to day doing our running the show. And that was always a challenge because, like, you're trying to develop procedures and you're trying to do things, but then at 4:30 you have to drop everything and go run 2 shows. So that was always a challenge. A lot of questions here, so we should address them. There's a good one here about what are some ways tips on forming and maintaining a strong working personal relationship with your stage management team? Nathan, Maz, you want to weigh in on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things that I liked about House of Dancing Water was that we would have a stage management meeting every week generally. They were often quite a heated affair because we would, you know, it was 8 to 9 stage managers who would all have varying opinions on how things should be functioning. But it was good because it meant that there was one time a week where we all came together, because often what would happen is that, you know, the the people who are doing lineup and schedule, they're mostly in the office all the time. The people who are running the stage trainings during the day would be down on deck running the stage trainings. And then during the show, everyone's on their own tracks. Like, you're all on comms together, but you're not really having a chance to really talk to each other. So sometimes, like, during the week, you wouldn't, like, if you were on lineup and you were literally at your computer for hours of the day, you wouldn't really interact with anyone. So it was nice to have that chance where we would all kind of sit together and we could all bring our issues or our thoughts about, you know, everything that was happening with the show and kind of chat together about that. You know, as I said, we didn't always agree on everything. We often had quite different opinions on things, but at least we were all taking the time to talk about it as a team rather than talking, you know, individually, always in groups.
For sure. And I'd add to that, that just obviously we're talking about Dancing Water, which is like unique in that the building itself was so large, so people wouldn't see each other no matter where they were, what they were doing throughout the day. But different people kind of had different responsibilities in such a way. For example, like the ASMs would take the moto team to offsite moto. So things kind of weren't working well off-site, or there were things that kind of needed to change in terms of, you know, where emergency equipment was placed or any kind of like the just general stuff about the process of going to an off-site location and coming back in terms of timing and all that. I felt really empowered to be able to kind of lead ideas and kind of make suggestions, because it was known that me and the other ASM who was there, it was kind of, that was our baby. That was something that we led and we managed. And having a management team that supports you in a way that they implement changes upon you without getting your constructive feedback and almost wanting you to lead the change because you're the one dealing with the issues. Same thing with all of the towel dramas that we've had throughout the years, because towels will always come up at least once a month. So that kind of stuff, people were on the ground running those tracks that were dealing directly with loading and unloading wet towels and prepping dry ones during the top of day trainings and stuff. Those people were really valuable to lead those changes and lead those discussions, even though they may have been assistant stage managers and not senior stage managers. So in a way, that kind of title was very, very important in terms of like the management structure and knowing who to go to for different information. But when it came to the tasks themselves, that kind of dissolved and it kind of turned into a bit more of a meritocracy in terms of the person who dealt more with the task was the person who probably had the most amount of knowledge to steer a certain change in a certain direction. That makes you feel really, really valuable, even if you've just been there for 6 months.
Give him a context of what the towels were, though, Nathan, just so everyone.
I think I'm wondering if I remember the numbers. I think we went through something like 4,000 towels a week in terms of floor.
Yeah, that sounds about
right.
We had
several large bins that held maybe 400 towels each that were just, we called them people towels because they were generally used by the cast. But also different technical departments use those towels as well for their presets, like rigging up in the grid and the level 6 platforms and stuff, to kind of, water just got everywhere, as it does with an aquatic show. And then
that's,
we had this
towel,
like 8 or 10 towels stitched together horizontally, I think by the wardrobe department, that were these massive, massive just blankets of towels that we would place all around the B1 ring, which I think we counted was 160 meters in circumference, I think. But that would happen at the top of day. We would start the week with what, like a moto training, because that's when the B1 ring was mostly dry. And after that, the towels would go down. We would do our aquatic trainings, boat, Russian swing, that kind of stuff. The towels would, I think the towels would come up and then go back down after the moto act in the show, right? Something like that.
Yeah.
For the next reset for the next show. So
towels up and down. And I think I was only there doing that stuff for a few years, but based on like the expansion of time there, that kind of task kind of floated around between people. Like, would it be carpentry? Would it be stage management? Would it be, you know, different departments? And who was primarily responsible for this thing that so many people used all of the time? And so that level of teamwork between hundreds of people using thousands of towels per week was really like an amazing feat to get anything done.
Yeah. Nobody wanted to do the tails. Nobody. A really good question from Trillian is, do you feel that there's a hierarchy and power becomes challenging in a stage management team that size? I'll start with me and maybe the other guys can answer. I think, yes, there's been iterations of the team that were very, very challenging. And I'm of the way that I had liked to manage the department was that, that it was a fairly flat hierarchy, even though there were certain roles and responsibilities that were people were accountable for. I would also at times do a B1 track and lay towels, and other people who were stage managers would step up into the big seat and do the show calling and deal with those situations. So not every person that came to the department liked the fact that you could call the biggest show in the world to laying towels on a floor and picking up after performers, and everything in between was always part of your job role. And it's perhaps a quite an Australian approach in terms of, you know, not that you work up to do that, but, you know, one of my mentors always said to me, you know, if you ever want to be a good stage manager, you always have to be prepared to be the one to sweep the floor before the show starts. And that's the way that I approach the team. And if I needed to help the show get running, be on the floor cleaning up, or supporting anybody in the team, that was certainly the expectation. Having said that, people coming in the department from certain cultures did also not like that. They wanted to feel like that they'd earned their place, that they didn't need to do some of those things. So that became a management issue. And over the course, you know, we had a lot of, it was always managing a team of people and people's expectations of their roles and their authority. People who were new, who felt like that they should have more responsibility. People who were, been there forever, felt like that they should maintain their authority. All of those things, sprung up from time to time because we're in each other's faces, you know, 40 to 60 hours a week, and everybody has their own energy, their thoughts, their emotions they bring to the thing. And we're like, you know, I always used to compare it a little bit to being on a cruise ship because we could never escape Macau. We lived together, we hung out together, we had stage manager family Christmases together. We were a family. And so like a family does, we quabble and we fight and we get over it and we work through those things. And I don't know, you guys want to say anything about that? No,
I think we're all waiting for the other ones to talk. No, I mean, that's it. As you said, it's very difficult on a show like this because you don't have an outside world. You don't necessarily have, you know, people that you know outside of the building in the country. You know, I think, and I always found that really difficult because there was never really any separation. So then things that are going on at work, which, like, you know, now being back in Australia and being back in my home country, it's like, oh, well, if something's happening at work, then I'm going to go and see other friends or, you know, step aside from it. And you realize, like, how much of it is actually not that full on. But when you're in that environment, like, even the smallest thing can sometimes turn into something that's really big because you're literally living it all day, every day. And, you know, so it's very easy to get really caught up in the drama of it because that's all you're dealing with. And I think, like, you know, having now had a chance to be outside of Macau for quite a number of years now, you kind of realize that you know, the way that you reacted to things, you didn't need to react like that necessarily. And it wasn't as big and, like, you know, like being on house, you lived it every day. Like, you would literally wake up and check your emails and you would find out whether, like, you know, the lifts were working or they weren't working or someone was sick or someone was off. Like, you know, your day would start sometimes with a phone call of something being broken and that was immediately the rest of your whole day, you know. So you lived it 24/7. And I think that, like, especially going to La Rev after house, where Vegas is very different because people have such more of an outside life there, and they really come in, do the show, and then they go home. And anything that's happening at the show, well, you deal with that tomorrow when you're back in. You know, you don't have work email on your phone. You don't have people calling you all hours about various different things, you know. You know, we were on call, like, almost all the time. Like, the amount of times people would call you because, like, they got stuck out of the country, or they, you know, like, they'd lost their pass, or they couldn't get into the building, or like
got banned from Quebec.
You know, like,
you needed to go and collect them from the police station. Yeah.
Well, you know, there were always those ones. Like, you know, like, oh, sorry to call you on the weekend, but I've got this friend who's coming and I need to get them a visitor's pass. Can you do it now? Because they're coming first thing tomorrow morning. And you're like, it's my day off, but sure, I'll process your visitor pass. Like, you know, whereas, like, I think once you're outside of Macau, you can have a little bit more separation. So it's easier to have a bit more perspective. But it's hard sometimes when you're in the middle of it to have any outside perspective.
Well, and my advice to anyone coming to Macau and joining our team, or even joining, you know, any part of the show, was the people who survive longer term in Macau are the people who find something outside of work. So, and that's difficult because our hours obviously aren't very social, which is theatre in general. Like, our days off are when most other people are working and all that sort of thing. But the people who were able to find that distance and create that real balance are the people who were sort of, in a way, I guess, less bothered by some of the drama in the building, because the building was definitely a bubble. Like, the bubble that was Belgium sort of transferred to the bubble that was Macau, and you know, and it was really easy to live and breathe the show 24/7 and not create that distance. So, you know, I think that's my advice to all my students, actually, is always find that balance, find an interest outside of the theatre, because it does actually protect your professional life as well.
For sure. And I think somewhere where you're in somewhat of an exotic or different environment, you might not be able to find balance in terms of, like, you know, we might want to break it down for ourselves in terms of, okay, what can I do every morning as a routine to start the day in a certain way, or what can I do after work every day to kind of have a sense of normalcy in life. You can expand that if you have the tolerance and patience to expand that over a period. It can be like, well, where am I going to go for the next week? And I can fly to Thailand for $20 for 2 days. And then the next day I can fly to Seoul for 2 days. And the next week I can fly to somewhere else. So you can kind of use that work experience to actually facilitate a whole different kind of lifestyle as well. And you see a lot of people doing that very differently throughout the building, which was really cool. A lot of people would come back from the weekend with stories from different countries, but other people like myself would try and find the underground scene and try to go to gigs on Fridays and Saturday nights, like the past midnight kind of music stuff to just see what was around. But as Mads was saying, it's super tough. I think especially when we were all there several years ago, Macau now has kind of a lot more stuff going for it. But at the time, it didn't really have much in terms of external to casino entertainment. It kind of really didn't exist.
That's true. A question from Alroy. Can you speak a little bit about the aerial and water aspects of the show? How is it introduced to the SM team? So the interesting part about most people who come to the show is, even if they've had some kind of aerial or automation experience, they're generally not ready for the scale and scope that is the House of Dancing Water. I got my experience calling for Cirque du Soleil in Las Vegas, the Beatles show Love, which I did for 2 years, the first 2 years of that show, actually. And in that, we dealt with a lot of, in the first 2 years of any show is when you get a lot of the technical problems that you don't know exist, basically. And so you discover that and you have to learn to deal with it. So that's where I cut my teeth in that. So which gave me the preparation to have the skill set to build a show. And unfortunately, because of that, it became a very, very complex show to teach. The onboarding and process was a process, I would say, that is layering. So also the team, we would give them the opportunity to get their scuba certification in the pool so that they could understand what the performers were doing underwater, and also what the scuba divers who run underwater tracks. Because the better show caller you are is a result of your knowledge about the entire building and its functionality. And I even said at some point when some of the people who worked backstage ended up calling the show, they made better decisions than me about the cast because they knew where the cast were, as opposed to me who had never run all those backstage tracks and I didn't have the inner workings behind that, behind the scenes. So they could make some quite ballsy decisions on the fly because they knew if those people could get to that position to continue the show. So it was a process of layering. With all of the automation and aerial things, there's a lot of training procedures. We mostly would train people into the training aspects of it, so they'd learn to do that in a safe, slow training environment. And the aquatic stuff, it's kind of one and the same because they learned what clears you need to get to call the lifts up and down, how you communicate with the aquatics department to move those lifts and communicate to the divers. And then, you know, slowly building up. But this is not something that happens over a period of weeks. It happens over a period of months. And in an ideal situation, if you can think about it in terms of time, between somebody walking into the building and knowing nothing about the show to being an effective stage manager without show calling is probably at least a 9-month process in an ideal training scenario. So it's 9 months before you're actually competent in all the aspects of stage management, and then another 2 to 3 months to become a competent show caller. So you're really talking about a year training period to get people into being a fully effective functioning member of the department. And if you can imagine that, when we hired people, I'd always be saying, okay, I need you here for 2 years. And that was always the goal, because you spend 12 months training the person, and if they left, all of that work, which is a strain on the department as we onboard everybody and get everybody into that rhythm, then is thrown out the window because you have to start that process again. So not only is it as expensive to bring somebody in and out of Macau from a human resources point of view, but then it's also a labour-intensive thing if you're having somebody stay under 2 years, which is why, you know, the guys that are here in this thing, you know, they were such valuable team members by the time they left, because they'd spent, once you're in your 3 years in, you really hit your stride. Like, you're on it. Like, you know everything about the show, you know all the nuances, you know how to manage the show, and it's a hard thing to wrap your head around, because generally in theater you can get your head around all of that fairly much in a much faster process. But that's how complex the show was, and we were always very due diligence, because I never wanted anybody to be killed or hurt in the situation, and show callers in our show can make bad decisions and can kill people if they do the wrong thing. So we would take that really slowly. Anybody else want to comment on that?
I think generally in terms of like on a personal level, the kind of 1 year rule is just something I apply to myself in general, regardless of the scale of the production, because you kind of, even though you might carry on, you might carry with you a lot of confidence and adapt really quickly to lots of environments, it's really just when you start to get to the nuances of the environment, the nuances of the people and the technology, that, as you said, like when you really start to become effective within the team and effective for the other teams that are around you as well. And particularly for this environment, like totally agree with that 3 year statement, because it wasn't until then that all of a sudden fear that I didn't know that I was carrying all of a sudden dissolved, and I wasn't kind of a little bit nervous before calling a show, or kind of really needing to prepare for a couple of hours for a show validation the next day on trainings. Like all that stuff kind of went away, and it all just became really second nature. And I think that kind of, especially if you're used to a touring environment where you're jumping on different shows or jumping to different places over and over and over again, you develop this kind of stamina to be really, really quickly responsive to things, but in a very general sense. So you can't really get into the nuts and bolts of things intuitively, because you've kind of deprogrammed that from having an environment of contracting or going to very, very rapid succession of shows or locations. So it's kind of, that was a really cool thing about being in this resident situation, where you could really just kind of just relax and enjoy the process, really. Just let it all kind of wash over you, and eventually, like, everything just sticks on its own. You don't really have to make too much of an effort to really excel. You just need to give yourself the patience and space to learn it.
Very different, I think, to, you know, Anna and, you know, Rex as well, and myself, is we were more frog in the pot kind of mentality. you know, rather than coming in and the show's already built and you have to learn every single thing from scratch, we had the luxury of, you know, each day building a little bit something more. You know, the pagoda act, you know, as it ended up with, you know, four on the roof, the six girls around and the two upstage, it started with just the four on the roof. So you really got a good knowledge of those winch cues, you know, how that one nut and bolt of the act actually comes together. And then you add another element. So, you know, we had that luxury of, you know, really learning the show from its start and how you got to the end result with an act. So knowing all of the history of the act, and I find that with Cirque as well. I've come into a show where I don't know the act, you know, where I didn't build the acts, the aerial acts particularly. And then I recently had the chance when we moved Lucia to the Royal Albert Hall, we brought another trapeze artist in and I did build that act from scratch. And even after being on the show for, you know, 3 years, I know that new act better than I know the original act, just because I have such a, you know, a more part of creating that act that I know it so much more intimately. And, you know, you never forget that sort of, it's a better way of learning, I guess, something, you know, the history of every single cue. And, you know, Anna knows the history of every single winch cue on that show. She built every single one of them. And, you know, having that knowledge is a real, it's amazing when you're calling a show to have that knowledge, because when something goes wrong, you have such a, you know, such a history of being able to know exactly where you can go with that, you know, and how to get out of that issue.
You just sparked something in my mind, Dean, that's kind of related to that previous question we had about onboarding SMs and about kind of just like feeling comfortable and that kind of stuff in terms of managing teams and whatnot. The sense that sometimes in an environment you can feel like you're teaching someone something that isn't theirs. So you're being taught something that belongs to someone else, or you're being taught something that you have to maintain or you have to kind of uphold in a certain way. Whereas this kind of teaching environment that was more layered and a lot more patient and kind of a lot more rigorous as well, like the documentation at house, like I don't think I've ever seen anything like that before. And sometimes it was a real ache to update when one little thing would change and you would have to change five different documents because it pertained to so many different aspects of the show, because everything was so interconnected. Yeah. But it was so valuable because someone could come in and as soon as you stepped up into that next level of like, okay, now you're going to call straps for the first time on training and it's a cross training, so it's just southeast, really, really simple, like just some rope rescue stuff. You have all this documentation to sit down with a stage manager or a tech to really kind of decode everything that comes with that technology so you can understand it. But then you kind of learn it in a kind of inheritance kind of way, where all of a sudden that part of the show, like as it grows, it starts to become something that you inherit and something that you own as well. It's like it's literally ours to share. So it's kind of like that kind of, again, speaks to the management style, especially in a big team, to be really successful, where things can't really be owned by particular people to be given. It's something that we all have to take on and something that, you know, really has to like allow us to contribute back into, I guess, something like that.
That's true. There's a couple of quick questions that we can answer there. Justin asked how many cues were in the show. It's like 375, 376 in 90 minutes, so on average about one every 15 seconds, some of them faster than not. And if you bear with us, we'll show a video of Mads recovering a problem. It's just fun to listen to.
It's probably worth noting as well, because I know that this comes up a lot for people who aren't familiar with circus, is that we don't call lighting cues. We only call automation in terms of our show, like special effects or effects cues, and then, you know, aquatics cues and other little bits and pieces as well. But that's a big one that surprises people whenever I talk about the show, is that we don't actually call lighting, which is quite different to normal theatre and music theatre especially.
Yeah, definitely. And
Anna, you were saying 390 cues, that's 390 aerial cues, because then there was lifts and SFX on top of that, correct?
No, I think that was, I think I counted it was like 300. You know, I never bothered because it's
sounding
crowded. We did count, but impressive. I can't remember what it was.
Alden also says, what's a resident show? And I, excuse me if we use terminology that's not familiar to you guys. A resident show is a permanent show that doesn't move around. It stays in the one spot. And generally the theatre is custom built for its execution for a circle or environment. So the House of Dancing Water was custom built for the show. As we were building the concept of the show, the design of the theatre was also supporting and being installed in the manner in which that was built. So Cirque du Soleil refer to their shows as resident shows and touring shows. The resident shows are the ones that don't move, all the ones in Vegas, the one in Florida, et cetera, et cetera. So is lighting called with time code? They use time code for certain special effects and lighting use time code for certain sequences, but it's a combination of people who are, they take their cues off us a lot of the time and off visuals, but they're not hearing us call lighting cues especially, because if we're calling all of the winch cues, they're going to know that that winch is moving, so they're going to bring the lighting state up on that. But it's just simply too much for one person to take. There's also, just so you guys know, another layer. There's two show callers in the show. One is the main show caller of what the things that you see, and then you've got an aquatic show caller, and they manage all of the things that are moving under the water. So they're calling a whole separate show, and they give the clears to the main show caller who bring the lifts in and out of the water. But they do another layer of calling that's underneath it. So it's very, very, very complex, I guess. So.
And it's really interesting having a lighting operator who's responsible for their own cues to a certain extent, because I found in massively technical sequences during the show, you know, with the lighting operator taking their own cues, if there was something like artistically not quite right or if there was a light missing, I was too focused on what the winches were doing, whereas they would pick up that projector's gone out, that light's not where it should be, that light's gone rogue, Faye's not standing in the right spot, you know. They would pick up on like this, that side of things more quickly than I would, if particularly if it was in the middle of a massive technical sequence. So it was actually really useful having the lighting operator have such an be so connected at that level as well.
And they were right next to us as well, so you could speak to them directly if there was any issue, you know.
And that was, I mean, that was the same at Le Rev. And I tell me. Cirque people if I'm wrong, but I think it's the same across Cirque as well. You don't call lighting cues. Like that's just the standard of Circus. They have a cue sequence within their own system that tells them when to take the cues. There's not a stage manager that's calling those cues.
You might call an occasional special cue or a snap cue if there's nothing tangible for the operator to take it on, you know, then
Yeah, and there were moments in the show too that we did call a couple of things, but not often. So let's just also give people a bit of context of the call and things like that. We'll show this video of Mads, but I'll preface it so you can explain. I'll explain exactly what is happening on there. So Madison's about to go into one of the most complex show calling sequences in the show, the Straps Act. It's very, very contingent on you calling it musically. If you get it wrong, you have to stop. And there's seven people or five people in the air, depending on which version of Straps you're doing. In this sequence, it's very funny. I love when I listen to it. So basically, they're going to go into a five-person Straps, but the riggers on the north side, on one side of the catwalk in the grid, had put the wrong strap on the winch. What that means is every person has their own, every acrobat has their own strap, and it has its own particular length, and it's set up particularly for that artist. So if you put the wrong strap on that. On that winch, then you, that person cannot fly on that a piece of equipment. So they realise this quite late, and then they communicate that to Madison. And what it is a great example of rigging, automation, and show calling working together to overcome that issue and continue the show without it pausing too much. I mean, there's a little bit of vamp of music there, but you can see that that the show didn't actually stop. So let's go to this. Have you guys seen it?
No, I haven't seen it.
Yeah, okay. I've used it. Sorry, Matt, yeah. I've used it.
All right, so here's the video, and then you guys can ask some questions about that because it gives you a little bit of context about what we deal with.
Wow. Winch Q225, go. Stand by, please. Winch Q's 240 to 3 to 5, lift Q's 27 to 34, auto Q300 and 310, SFX 220 to 240. The Poor Girl Catch, the Jean Catch, Fishmobile, and Stranded People.
Stand by.
Thank you.
Center one clear for preset.
Still waiting.
Copy. Lift Q27 and SFX 220. Go.
We have the wrong strap on north.
Copy. Do we need to pause here?
We can go for three if you want.
Okay. We will just. Yes, Sean, we will stand by to go with three. I'm just turning on the orange light. Let me know once you're ready. Mario here, if you could just vamp for just a second. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm standing by.
Okay, so we'll be standing by for winch Q240.
Standing by.
Thank you. We should get clears in just a second. Okay, stand by everyone. Winch Q240, go.
Hear me.
Okay, are you good, Sean, for me to continue?
That's complete.
Thank you. Okay, winch Q241, go. SFX 221, go. Lift Q27.5, go.
Hey, Madison, I'm sorry, I got a question. Is North flying or no?
North won't be flying.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Waiting for clears on South and in the centre well.
South is clear to fly.
Centre well clear to fly.
Thank you. Winch Q245, go.
Moving.
I know you're all feeling that anxiety right now by just watching it.
Three straps.
Donut set.
Thank you.
I'm just going to leave the orange light on here for a sec, so they see that we just have the three straps.
Clear the straps, music, Mario.
Donut set.
Thank you. Clear the straps, music, Mario.
It was a little bit of a double up there at the end, but yeah, so there you go. You get the idea of a lovely strap save by Madison.
It's probably worth
I just had a small panic.
It's probably worth noting that we had three straps validated. Like we'd actually rehearsed that and we knew that we could do it. We didn't, it was all built and ready to go. So it was all validated, but switching mid-show is not an easy thing to do. So
no, it was super intense.
But it also, in that situation that it was north, because you know the way that the sequences are built, like if it had been one of the south straps, we wouldn't have been able to do the three person version. So we were just lucky in that version that it was one of the north, because the sequences are only built in particular ways. So
No, it's absolutely good.
And that's great communication as well from automation coming in and saying what's achievable. Like that's really important in these kind of scenarios, is like everyone having a voice rather than just being left to the show caller to go, something's wrong, what's going on. Everyone jumps in and goes, this is possible, this is possible, this is possible. And that's what teamwork is about. That's the best of teamwork, you know.
Yeah, and then it goes back to what Nathan was saying in terms of those layers of information and competence and ability and having that depth and breadth of knowledge, not just in the stage management department but in all of the departments, helps for you to be able to overcome a problem in a very quick amount of time. Sorry, Rex, what were you going to say?
I just think, and it was quite evident in that situation with Mads and Sean, who was the automation operator, is that it's all about your relationship with the crew. When I started calling the show, I was sort of lucky. I think I started calling in, I don't know, April or something of 2011. And so I'd been around, you know, I had a relationship with most of the operators before I started calling. And I think that relationship actually, you know, served me well, but there was an incredible amount of trust between all of us in terms of responsibility. And, you know, I might call a queue, but if an aerial operator had seen something that they didn't think was right, it was totally within their responsibility to be able to go, I don't feel good about this, we're not running that queue, I'll keep it on the ground. So it's an incredibly strong relationship, and actually that's what's drawn me back to doing shows again, is I've missed that relationship. So
Yeah, there's definitely, I think especially with automation, there's such a, you know, it's such an important relationship, especially like if there is one primary operator or there is, you know, in the case of house, I think it was definitely the aerial operator in particular because they were the one flying the people. And there was definitely, I think when I first started calling, you could definitely, there was a turning point where you realized that you had people's trust, you know, where, and I, you know, where you could tell that the aerial operators actually trusted you. And that took time, you know, like it took a while you were calling. You know, when you first start calling, you have another stage manager who is a caller sitting with you for at least the first 3 to 4 weeks just to be present when you're calling to help deal if there's any sort of situations. And then eventually you get to a point where you're kind of by yourself, but it still takes a period of time for that person to have faith in you. And, you know, it definitely makes a difference when once you do earn that trust.
Mm. So Lucy has a good question, and I'll explain that because you hear Madison talk about it. She says, how did the actors know what was going on? Was it something you discussed being a possibility? So in that particular instance, the first thing that they would have realised that there was something wrong was that the music didn't kick straight into the Straps music. So that's a very like an immediate audible situation. When they hear that the music is not the same, they're going to look up at the booth. And Madison said, I'm turning the orange light on. And the orange light for the performers means, because as soon as they acknowledge that there's something wrong from an audio perspective, they're going to look at the booth for that communication. The booth then has the orange light on, which for us means stay on stage. We have an issue. We're going to try and fix it and improvise. The other alternative is there's a red light. We have to stop. You can let you leave the stage. So that's the two communication. Jordan, you're saying, was it live music? Yes, there's four live band members. So Madison called for Mario, who's the band leader, to vamp. So he leads that. There's a lot of backing tracks played on Ableton, but they have the ability to loop music and play live and vamp as we need, which is a super amazing thing to do, because when I worked on the Beatles show, it was all recorded and we ran it to time codes. So we had to stop a lot more often than we would in this situation where the band can keep us afloat for a little period of time. Then Madison kept the light on, and then she did bring the Straps guys in. She left the light on for a little bit longer so they could notice, hey, there's only three guys on stage instead of five. And then she turned it off as she went into the Straps music, because, like, now we're continuing, go as normal. You've seen what the issue is, and we trust that you're going to run the show without those extra people, which really just means there might have been a couple of dancers that are dancing without performers in the air, and it would have looked a little bit weird, but the audience probably would not have known what was going on, basically. Yeah. So, and just one other question, what I think is important to touch on, and maybe Mads, you love the schedule. What were the daily and weekly schedules like? Lamar is asking.
So we had, we produced the schedule for the entire building. So our schedule not only included what we considered to be like rehearsals, which was generally from like 12:30 till 3, I want to say, and then like the show as well, but also before 12:30 every day from like 6 a.m. There was maintenance. So we would also in our daily schedule include all the maintenance that was happening, then what was happening on stage for rehearsals, and then the shows as well. And then also, you know, the top part of the schedule included what was generally happening in the stage or the stage area. And then we also had a rehearsal room that was fitted out with a version of a lot of our acts, and then also a like dancing dance studio. And then various other, you know, small bits like wardrobe. We had a physio department, so we would include all of that. So we produced the schedule for the building. We would do a daily schedule for every day. So there was no overall week schedule. It was just like a daily schedule for each day that was released at the start of, at the end of the previous week. And then we would update each daily schedule as we went. So it would get updated and then sent out. And that was a process where the artistic and coaching teams would give us the information of what they wanted to achieve during the week. We would then put that into the schedule. It would then be taken to a meeting with all of the artistic heads and the artistic team to kind of sign off on. Then we would adjust it all, and then we would have a meeting with all the technical heads to talk them through the schedule, where they would adjust anything that they needed, and then we would send that out to everyone and then update, as I said, each day.
Yeah, pretty intense. So you guys have to do this and I don't, and I think it's a really good question. Lewis says, given your experiences on long-running shows, now a lot of shows are being on pause for during the pandemic. What would be your working processes if shows need to restart at some point? You all have to like, do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Certainly going back into a Cirque show, there's probably, you know, what I can imagine is going to happen, and there's not been a lot of communication yet as to how it's going to roll out when we come back. And I guess if we come back, you know, there is a potential that, you know, it's going to be a very long delay. And then that would mean for us potentially losing a number of our cast, losing a lot of our crew, and then really having to start, particularly, if we look at our aerial acts, if we haven't had someone operate an aerial act for 3 months, we have to revalidate them. And that's a, you know, like a 2 week process, say. So to revalidate, we're in a place now where we have two show callers who can call the act. We have three automation operators who can operate the act. But when we come back, we're going to have nobody validated to operate that act. So we're going to have to go back to square one with it and start and really rebuild it again from start with the first cue, talk with the artist about it, run that cue over and over again with the operator, make sure that we're all on the same page, that we all remember the acts, and then slowly and build those acts back up. I imagine that's going to be first step for all of the shows. I don't know whether that will happen outside of, you know, our big tops or our venues, if that'll happen up in Montreal or if that'll happen in other outside venues, just to get those the aerial acts back together. And then I really think the only way you can put those shows back together quickly and efficiently is on the stage in the big top, build the big top wherever it's going to be, get everyone back there, as many people as you can, and then try and put a show back together. You know, Luzia, and I think, you know, it's the same with Nathan's show. It's again, like House, these shows are never the same every night. And it's particularly down to artist injury, illness, you know, all of those kind of things that can take an act out for one night, for 1 month. We have a backup act which we can slide into various places within the show. But the overall show itself, we can chop and change it and present quite different ideas of that show depending on who's in or out and what acts we actually, you know, have that night. We obviously have the ideal show and we have the show that we want to present every night, but often it's not the case that we could present that due to illness or injury. So coming back to this whole thing, it's really going to depend on what acts come back. You know, if we're out for 3 to 6 months, some people might not be able to afford to support themselves for that time waiting for Luzia or their Cirque show to come back. So they might have to go off and do other things, get contracted jobs, and not be available to come back to Cirque. So we just have to see how long it goes on for. That'll give us a better idea of, you know, who we're going to get back and how we're going to be able to remount these shows. Everything is ready. You know, I know that, for example, our show, we set it up in the wonderful crew set it up over 5 days in Moscow. After it was literally they'd finished the job, we had the meeting that night or the next morning to say, sorry, we're not going to continue, we're going to pull it all down. So we sent all of the artists home. We had 8 of our artists who'd flown in the past couple of days from either France, Italy or Spain, and they were all actually in quarantine in their hotel rooms in Moscow. So we were going off doing grocery runs for them, leaving bags of shopping outside of their, you know, taking their orders, leaving their shopping outside their doors, and then, you know, giving them the space to collect it. So they were the first ones that we managed to get out once we'd cancelled the show. They'd been stuck in their rooms for 5, 6, 7 days. And we got them out first, then the rest of the performing artists, and then the crew went straight into loadout and pulled the show down over the next 3 days. And then they got out. I tell you, by the time they got out, it was getting very difficult to actually get people back home. And some people, I think we have one person who may still be in Moscow.
Gosh.
Yeah. And that was, I've been home 3 weeks. So, like it's, you know, he's been stuck there. He's in a South American country that's very strict. Well, I can't remember which one, but they have a very strict border policy where no one's allowed in or out, whether you're a citizen or not.
Yeah. There's a few like that now.
Yeah.
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 Now, we're almost hit 90 minutes, but I'm quite happy to stick around if you guys are to keep answering just a few questions that we've missed, because there's been a few there and I'd want to make sure that everyone gets their value. So if you guys are okay, we'll keep kicking through those questions. If anybody has to bounce around and leave, feel free to do so. And thank you for joining us. It's been a good session. Quite a lot of you have had some fantastic questions and engagement. So I think the one thing that there's a few people online that have been asking, what kind of skills or training is necessary to work on a technically complex show? How do you get work overseas? How do you sort of get into this environment? And I probably want to hear from you guys. It's like, what practical advice do you want to give anybody who's looking to expand from their country or get onto bigger shows or work for Cirque? What's their trajectory for that?
Work,
I think,
as much as you can. Do anything, absolutely everything. Like, find as much as you can if it's a community theatre. I know that Sophie Duncan's on this, you know, was watching this for a while. I'm not sure if she's still there. She was a dancer in Macau who became a house trip girl. She's always inspired me for her work ethic. You know, she's someone who's always approached me to say, hey, if you ever need an ASM on anything, you know, think of me. And I know that She gave an example a while ago. You know, she's an amazing performer who works in one of the top shows in the world. She left there for a while and she was pointing a follow spot at her local amateur dramatic musical society in whatever little town in the UK was, just to get that kind of experience, a different experience, pointing a follow spot. Like, a dancer doesn't need to learn how to point a follow spot, but she just wants to do more and more and learn and get every kind of facet of the industry that she possibly can. And I think that's really important for stage managers to learn all sorts of different skills, all sorts of different types of calling shows as well. There's a good question here from Kanoko saying, I heard Cirque show caller is calling all visual, or do you have a musical score in your prompt copy, or is it all time code? It's a mix. It's all a mix. And this is what I try and stress to the stage managers I'm teaching to call Lusia, is it's not all visual. It's not all musical. It's a combination. And particularly, it's interesting with the Cirque show is that it's definitely a visual and physical, you know, let's talk about an aerial act, for example. It's a physical act. It's a visual act. You know, that performer has to be in the right position physically before you can call that cue, no matter where we are in the music. However, a lot of acts that I've come into where I haven't, say, built the act, I've noticed that a cue happens just before a move, before a musical change. And it wasn't necessarily built that way, but in discussion and in the way that an act can progress over the years, you might just move that cue just to happen on that musical point, you know, so that you can call that in a dual way. You can call it musically, but you have to have the visual sign off first that person's in the right position. So it's always like a really quick mental process to go with if you're calling a Cirque show musically, if you like. And I certainly, I've come from a musical theatre background, so I like things to happen with the music. I think it looks better in a show. And particularly, I think it's more dramatic when an artist on a winch moves with the music at 100 miles an hour rather than, you know, outside of that music. It's not necessarily the right mentality. You know, there's a lot of different factors in where you call a cue. But from an old musical theatre stage manager, it always seemed to lean towards those musical points. But in a Cirque show, you can't rely on that music. You have to be watching the artists, and they have to be 100% in the right position and know exactly where they are physically in space before you can move on with that next cue. And most of the time, you have to throw the music out the window. You know, as soon as they're a second behind on the music, you're not going to catch to any of those musical points, and you just have to focus on them for the rest of the act. You know, not try and get it back to the music. The music's, you know, it's a luxury. It's not really relevant.
Anybody else
want to
weigh in on that? Yeah,
well, going back a little bit on the getting into the industry, especially into working overseas, what I've found in the last little while is it's kind of becoming a little bit more challenging because a lot of people want you to have experience before they're willing to hire you, but it's hard to get that experience if you haven't had a job, you know, a bit chicken and egg. But what I tell a lot of any students that I interact with is, I think from what I've seen, not having experienced myself, but seeing a lot of other people do it, is cruise ships are a really good way, because you get that chance to kind of get more into an international scene, especially coming out of Australia. And they tend to be a lot of like all hands on deck in a lot of ways, literally. So you get really good experience in a lot of different areas that you wouldn't get here, like especially in terms of if you're interested in automation or being an automation operator. Like, you know, not a lot of shows in Australia have automation. If they're going to hire someone to do automation, it's someone who's been doing automation for, you know, 10 years. So how do you get that experience? Whereas like there's a lot of cruise ships that now have shows that, you know, the stage manager does automation, or you can have that chance to really learn a lot of different things because it's a smaller environment where you're doing more things, and therefore you also get a lot more international contacts. You know, with Cirque now, it's really difficult to get a job on the resident shows, especially if you're not American, because they're generally not going to hire outside America. Whereas, like, you know, obviously the touring shows, it's a bit easier, but at the same time, because with the touring shows, they often want people who already have calling experience, you know, you have to already have that calling experience, you know. Even with musicals, it's the same to an extent, because a lot of the times they want, because the whole team, it's more often a smaller team, so therefore the whole team needs to be able to call the show. So even for an ASM, they want someone who already has calling experience, because they can't afford to bring on an ASM that they're going to train, because they need that person to be able to be calling the show within a month or 6 weeks of that show opening. So I find that, you know, if you can, maybe regional touring is also a good way, especially in Australia, if you want to get some touring experience. But definitely, like, if you're more interested in the technical kind of acrobatic side, that cruise ships are a good way to do it.
Like the New Year's Eve events and all of the city events that happen around Australia, if you guys are in Australia, or look up your local councils and your local whatever cities you're in. You know, there's New Year's Eve every year. In Australia, there's Australia Day every year. They take on a huge amount of people just to organise the city and to run all of the events. I know that Australia Day in Sydney has 5 or 6 stages running, you know, almost 24 hours on Australia Day, and a whole bunch of stuff going on around the city. They're all really good ways in for a lot of people to into the industry, you know, to get experience on, you know, helping run a small stage for the city of Sydney for, you know, maybe there's only 6 bands coming onto that stage in that day, but that just gives you some experience in how things run. And the more experience you get, you know, the better you are coming into any kind of big show, because there's, you know, no matter what gets thrown at you, what kind of calling, what kind of scheduling, anything, you've already done it. You know, you've already got some experience in it. You've done some, you know, big events or theatre or anything.
And I think, like, in a – sorry, you go, Rex.
No, I was just going to say, if you are a student in a university or a college, and you have a specific area that you want to get into, you know, use those work placements or those secondments that you invariably get in your final year normally, to try and focus into that area. But don't just go in and sit back, and this is going to sound really silly, but, you know, I have seen it happen on occasion. You know, make sure, treat it as a job interview. Like, you know, if shows are going to be looking for ASMs in the future, and you've done a secondment there and you've actually essentially done a brilliant job interview, you'll be the person that'll, you know, will be on that list to call initially. So every opportunity you get to go out and interact with professionals, it, you know, treat it as a job interview. And if you are, you know, a lot of the universities have different people come in, different professionals come in and do specific lectures on opera and dance and music theatre and circus, all that sort of, all the different areas of stage management, essentially. If you see them at an opening night in a couple of weeks, you know, 2 months down the track, go and say hello. They like to be remembered. They like to see the next generation coming through. So just remember, it's a part of you are a part of a far wider network, and that connection is really important.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what Madison did. I mean, she went from an internship into the department. Yeah. And I can just say, from somebody who's taken on a lot of internships, you know, and we'll all agree, there were days where you're just like, how did we do without this person? Because he or she came into the department, and suddenly they started laying towels and they started doing the things, and you'd be God, I love having that person around. And then there were other people that you'd be like, what do we get such and such to do today? Because it was like babysitting them. And that's obviously not the audition you want for long-term work. You want to hit the ground running. You want to take everybody's take everybody's experience, learn from that, and participate even to the smallest extent where you can. I mean, not to say you should be running and getting coffees all the time, but, you know, hell, I'll run and get coffees for the team if they're busy, you know. So it's not, you know, whatever, wherever you can help out. If you came into our team and you didn't see that we're busy as F, and we're running around like with our chickens with their heads cut off, which is probably an Australian expression, and you're not going to help contribute to that, then you're not going to get employed in the department. So, you know, jump in, dive in, keep in touch with your international connections, make international connections. I always say, because I do a lot of webinars on Theatre Art Life, give me your CV, give me your things, stay in contact, dialogue with me. I get up, well, not right now, but usually I get approached quite a lot for people, looking for people in China and Asia. There's always a need for people to be working in the area, and a lot of people don't have those connections. So just stay in touch with all these people that are on the webinar today and anyone you know overseas, and keep bugging them, because the ones that do keep bugging me are the ones I remember, and they're the ones that I will pull out of the hat when I get asked.
And most people want to connect and they want to help you. So, like, I always give, whenever I do any, you know, lectures or anything like that, I always give out my email address. And as a student myself, I would literally have a document that had every stage manager that came in and their contact details. And I kept that, you know, you keep that information so you can contact those people when it does become time to do your secondments or where you do want to get that experience.
Yeah. And the other way around, if you're taking on secondments as well, like I've kept a list of good secondments over the year, and I'm lucky enough to do like Olympic Games opening ceremonies in Sydney and London, and all of the secondments and interns who worked on those games in stage management particularly are all now working stage managers, the ones who are worth their salt. But you rely on them so heavily, you know, you need that assistant, you need people to help you out, you need people to go, do you need anything? Can I help you with anything before I leave? Do you want a cup of coffee? You look exhausted, you know. It's those things that really help you out in those, you know, those real big jobs, those real crunch times. And they're the people that you remember and the people you hang on to for the next job. You bring them automatically with you to the next job, you know.
Dean, that's a really good point. What I wanted to kind of contribute as a bit of a contrast from talking about, and all of us, I know, have been through this time where we've really focused on like toughening up our hard skill set, where we're like, what more can we learn? What languages can we learn? What things can we do in work experience, and what jobs can we take? How can we build up the CV, all this stuff? But we completely neglect to develop the soft skill set, which when you get to an interview process where you have 10 people who are all qualified for the job, most of the time the people that are going to be hired are the ones that have actually taken the time to work on themselves, that can bring really clear communication, that are very honest, very open, transparent, don't have an ego, and are just kind of there just to have a good time, to be passionate about a project, to own a project, and to be a part of a family. So kind of get, for me, when I kind of transitioned from that ASM to, I guess, SM mindset, and I would say it was a big transition in mindset, it stopped becoming this thing of, I need to... For me at the time, it was balancing out my hard skill set, because I didn't come from a traditional theatre background. I didn't study stage management or working in it. I kind of learned everything crewing overnights with Oz Crew and just doing all of these gigs for music festivals and stuff with mates. So it was kind of a very different growing experience. But realizing that I had so much of a soft skill set and was really, really good with people, but really needed to balance that out with the hard skill set and the solid knowledge. But then you see a lot of it coming in the opposite direction, especially people coming from rigorous study, being in university for years after high school, there's kind of not much of support to develop personally, which when you get into the working world or when you're trying to break into the international kind of scene as well, people are so different, and just bringing all of your stuff to that place isn't always going to be the thing that's going to get you over the line. It's about being perceptive and open, I think, as well as having all of that real knowledge too.
Yeah. No, it's the importance of the soft skills is equally as important as the hard skills. You know, you've got to be able to do the job, but you've got to be able to do it as a nice person as well. You know,
sure.
Really.
But also too, it's also about dynamic and just, you know, in a large team like we were at House of Dancing Water, like it was also about fitting the right person in, the ninth person into an existing team of eight and making sure that that dynamic worked. That person might have been brilliant and perfect for the team like 12 months down the track, but just not in its current skill set and current group of people. So, you know, I guess it's a case of don't get disheartened if you do get interviewed and then you don't get a gig, because sometimes it is also about, you know, it's also about matching the dynamic. So, you know.
I would totally second that, Rex. And I really, as a young manager, when I first started out, made some mistakes because I would hire people for their capability and not necessarily their ability to be a team player. And over the years, I learned really, you know, I started to select people that were perhaps a little less qualified from a hard skill set, but felt like that they would have more of that openness and that idea of, I mean, Nathan knows, I said no to him for about a year and a half before I brought him to the department, because I was like, I'm not ready to take someone as green as you. I'm not ready for you to, you know, we can't accommodate that learning curve. It's too balls to the wall at the moment. But when that position opened up and he kept in touch, because to his credit, he'd email me every few months or whatever and check in with me. And he was there in the back of my mind. And so by the time that, and the way that he kept approaching me in this beautiful open way was like, yeah, we could take you on now. This is, let's take a chance on you and bring you into the department. And so, you know, and then I started to look, even if people had a less skill set, but they were going to fit into the dynamic of the team, we'd put and have the tenacity to want to stay in Macau for at least 2 years was another big factor. Were they ready to take on that cultural adaptation? Were they ready to deal with that? And then that really changed my mindset in terms of hiring. And then to go back to what Nathan said, I mean, Nathan and I remember that conversation we had. Nathan, you're an amazing guy, but you're not qualified to be a stage manager because you haven't worked hard on your skill set. And it was a very lovely conversation, because what was so great about Nathan was so open to take that criticism and take that constructive criticism and go away and work on it. And now he's turned into one of those people that I wouldn't hesitate to recommend for any bloody job around the world, because he just works so hard at it. And working those relationships, not only with artistic directors and things like that, but with other stage managers and those sort of people that can help you grow as a person is completely invaluable. Mm. Yeah. Let's quick on, because we're going to have so few, we'll be here forever. Alicia asks about work-life balance with family. Rex, you're up. No? Are you on mute or are you...
I muted this time because my cats are running around like crazy things. But anyway, you know, it is challenging as a in one way, it's incredibly challenging to be working on any show and be a wife and a mum and, you know, trying to have a life outside of the theatre. But on the other hand, it actually forces you to have that balance, because you actually sort of don't have a choice, because you've got little people who need you and need your attention and need you to be 100% focused on them outside of the theatre. I actually really enjoy talking about this, because I think it's really important for people who are, for young women in particular and anyone really coming through the stage management ranks. It is possible to be a working stage manager and be a parent. It's a juggling act, and it's always going to be a juggling act, but for my non-theatre friends, it's still a juggling act. One of my very good friends at the moment is working for Queensland Government in their COVID response. And she's got two kids and she's constantly juggling. So it's not just within the theatre industry that you do have to juggle. It is, the difference with us is obviously that we don't really work in daycare hours. And so just childminding after hours can be challenging. Totally possible. And also one of the most rewarding things to do is find that balance, and kids are the best, except for mine that are running around like people.
Baby Mondays, remember?
Baby Mondays. Well, that's right. We did have a joke. There was a while there on House of Dancing Water where it seemed like there was just babies every week. I guess, you know, one of the benefits of being on a resident show is that people do feel secure and you do feel settled and you can make decisions to have families and sit down and enjoy working a Thursday to Monday week with 2 days off mostly. And you know, it actually gave people a lot of security. And, you know, only been with Harry Potter for a couple of weeks, but just some of the conversations there have also been similar. Like, resident show, people have felt secure. They've families have been started. There's lots of babies, and people are doing things like buying houses, which when you sort of not a lot of people get the opportunity to do. So and it's also great to work. We were very lucky. We were in a department that was very, the artistic division as a whole were very accepting of having kids around. So there were times where we'd bring the kids into the building, they'd hang out in the stage management office. There's like a whole series of photos of Anna's kids with headsets on and hanging out in the office with the team. So it's a doable thing. It's a juggle, but being a parent is a juggle anyway.
I think also I'd add to, apart from your own personal quest, I think it's really important for women and men who are advocates of that to put pressure on any company that you work for to work towards a friendly environment if it isn't there, and allow that to be highlighted. A lot of people exclude thinking about family balance or work-life balance if they don't have it themselves. So you've got to sort of, open their eyes to be like, I've got shit to deal with here at home, and I've got things, we set up a room for people to pump breast milk at the House of Dancing Water because it didn't exist before, and we stole it. But we couldn't go through the ranks to get the official permissions, but we got a swipe card and handed it out to the breastfeeding mums. But you've got to be a champion for each other, and also allow flexibility. These guys know I was pregnant when we created the House of Dancing Water. That was absolutely terrifying. I wouldn't recommend people do that. But I was the, like Rex said, you had to make it work because, there was this pragmatic thing of like, okay, the show's now opened. I opened the show when I was 5 months pregnant, and I had a certain period of time where we had to hand that over to, hand over your knowledge so somebody else could call the show so you could actually go and give birth, And so it's always been completely intertwined into my life, parenthood and work, in some of the most extreme cases, and my husband also worked on the show, and there was one point in time for about a 10-month period that I was his boss. I would not recommend that. Nearly killed us both, and it's really hard to find that separation. But I have, like going back to Nathan's thing about cultivating your life outside it, being a well-balanced individual, I've always practiced yoga. That's kept me sane. My kids are a huge focus and a driving motivation for me now, and I would really, really encourage any women that think about wanting to become parents, just don't hesitate. You'll find a way to work and make it happen, because you don't want to turn around wanting to be a mother or a father for that case, and then turn around in your sort of late 40s and go, oh geez, I missed out and I really wanted that. So I would recommend that.
Can I say, like, one of my favorite things about House of Dancing Water, and I've not experienced this on any other show, is how open we were, like, as a show and as a company and as a building, Like, I've not worked on, and maybe it is similar on the tent shows because I've not worked in that environment, but, we could literally, pretty much any rehearsal that happened, you could have family or friends attend. We allowed people to sit in the booth and listen to the show call. We allowed them to sit with Aquatics and listen to their show call. We had people come to the green room and have dinner with their families. Like, all, they could come under the right circumstances and do yoga classes or do dancing training or, other trainings. They could work out in the gym or the rehearsal room. We had our backstage experience, so you could actually, experience the show from backstage. I've not worked on a show like that where you really, the families and friends, especially the ones that didn't live in Macau who came to travel to see the show, could get such an in-depth knowledge of what we did, especially when you're not a performer, because I feel like when you're a performer, it's pretty, like, people have a very clear idea mostly of what you do because they can physically see it on the stage. But for the people who worked in wardrobe or rigging or stage management, you know, lighting, any of those crew roles, for those people to be able to see so much behind the scenes, to actually understand what we do. Because I think so many families, if you're, you know, they don't understand what we, like, our family and friends don't actually understand what we do.
Well, I literally met my wife because of that. Like, she came to see the show because one of the other stage managers knew her. She watched me call the show from one of the positions that we had in the booth. And that was it.
She fell in love.
Now we're married.
Those dulcet tones, Dean. Those dulcet tones.
The dulcet tones of Dean's show call. And she was hooked. Question about, from Lucy, about reports, show reports. Anyone want to weigh in on how we did show reports? Database, anyone?
That's you, database.
I mean, the great thing in Cirque is the database, they have a thing, Aurora is the Cirque database. We had something similar at House, but it automatically generates from the lineup, it automatically generates your show report. And from the, you know, you run Aurora live during the show to put all the timings in that are going on. You time each song, essentially. But at the end of it, it automatically generates a show report. You just whack some comments in and any notes that have gone on. But it's all sort of integrated, which is really nice. Was House that integrated? It was a separate document, wasn't it?
It was part of the database. Some of the information came from the lineup, but I think the thing with our database especially was how much we tracked our statistics. So there was a very particular way in which you had to input information so that the database would generate the statistics in the right way, so we could see, you know. And I think that was definitely one of my most, you know, greatest things that I was involved in, was the database and the development of the database, from being able to use it just to do kind of the lineup and the basics of what we did with the show reports, to really truly integrating like all of the artist information, all of that paperwork that we were able to generate. Like, I know when I started there was a lot of paperwork that we generated by hand, and we updated by hand. And any time a new artist would come on, there was a process of like updating every single piece of paperwork. And more we were able to integrate that within the database itself, so that you would literally do one form for an artist, and then you could press like print and everything would print out that you needed for that person, and all of the updated document that was required. But that was like, that was such a thing that drew me to this show, as opposed to Cirque, I think, because it was so new and it was so, you know, it was such a new process that there was such an ability to be able to be part of that development of how those systems work, which for me, that was, you know, such a great joy, was the, you know, as lame as it sounds, but developing like the administrative side of those
now systems. The SM nerd is coming out.
Let's be real, we always knew this about me.
It was,
we had our show report, but we also did a daily report as well, so it was almost like two major things would happen each day. We would have all the show gossip and the show report and that stuff, and then you would have like the daily stuff. So we would track all of the trainings that went on stage, how long they went for, whether they were interrupted, whether they were cancelled, whether they were postponed for other reasons, and by which department as well. And it wasn't in a way to point fingers, it was in a way to kind of make them more efficient in the long run, so that we could develop. Having only 2.5 hours, 4 days a week for acrobatic training for 90 artists with what, 18, 19 acts in a 90-minute show, something like that, there's like, it's a lot to try and squish in to be able to maintain over a long period of time. And having these databases, and again, all of that documentation that you can create from just quick drop downs, was like, oh, it was incredible. All of that. And like Madison said, like, you started, maybe you were there like a year before I was. And even when I went there, it was still a bit raw. Like, it was still kind of finding its way to being what it was by the time we left, where it was super polished, nice and slick.
Well, and the data that comes from that is completely invaluable. How many show stops do we have this year? What were the reasons for? Where do you need to focus more maintenance, or where are the injuries happening? What are the most problematic acts that, you know? And then you line that up with physiotherapy's or performer wellness's data, and you can find these correlations that could make then, you know, capping per people's show loads or whatever. You know, you've got this data that's not just people's opinions. It's there in front of you, yeah, that you can make an analysis on. And on a long-term running show, that's completely invaluable to be making the right decisions to protect performers, to protect the equipment, to keep people safe, and all of that. So that's where, you know, thanks to the people who worked on all of the database, took it from its very initial form of just telling people where they were on stage every day to a whole system that supported that show. Rex, you were going to say something?
I was just going to say that, you know, two things. One, you know, that's one of the benefits of having a new person coming into the team too, because the systems we developed during creation were all, as much as we had prepared prior to creation starting, we didn't know what the show was when creation started. So you couldn't prep them up. You couldn't build a database without all of that knowledge, essentially. So we developed systems that got us through creation, and then, you know, for the 12-month period after creation, when the show was still shaking down, we were still learning how to run it on a daily basis. We're still learning what can be modified, what can't be, training new show callers, training new people backstage, integrating new artists. Like, it didn't give us a lot of time to step back and really evaluate our processes in that initial period. Having someone new, a couple of new people coming into the department, and they'd be like, This is interesting, but why do you do it like this? And you're like, why do we do it like this? So you're able to, you know, actually sort of reevaluate our processes and then streamline from there. And it was a really long process of that streamlining, which ultimately culminated in a massive revamp of the database, which is what Madison's talking about. And the other thing is that's the statistics that we managed to get from the database and from performer wellness. One of our head physio was definitely a statistician, a statistics man. He loved good data. Data from our database and from physio actually resulted in a really big show change in 2016, which was the removal of the bob weights from straps, which was because we could see that the straps profile was getting, they were the most injured profile, and it was specifically resulting to their work on, specifically coming from their work on straps, and we were able to then work out a way to make it easier on their bodies on a daily basis. And that was a really long process, and we sort of knew that it was going to happen at some point, but we also had the data to back it up and spend that time and that money to do it.
A couple of good questions which we should touch on is, was there a union presence on a show like this, and were we working under a union contract? The answer is no. The contracts were built on a basis of the artistic director plus Macau labour laws, which don't really fit for the model that is our show. There's been a lot of controversy over the years about what was right and what was wrong, but generally I think if you look back and other performers have gone to other shows and realised that their contract that they had at the House of Dancing Water was pretty damn good. And I never had any complaints. We had a full insurance. We got paid adequately. The tax bracket in Macau is like 4.something%. It's nothing. So in terms of like rights and obligations, that was always a very interesting battle, because obviously people are coming from, heads of department are coming from different places in the world, the UK, Australia, US, and they've all got their perception about the rights and the responsibilities of their workers and what they're entitled to and not. And that, as a in a management sense, it was always a constant debate and something that you would individually as a head of department have to fight for and defend, basically, and try and get the best possible working conditions for your staff. Not an ideal situation, but that was its reality. So, what else? We got any other questions? We'll answer the visual. Matthew Shiner had a question. He said, what about inheriting your staff as opposed to hiring them yourself? Maybe you guys could probably attest to that. I had built my team from scratch and got total any choice that I had, if it was a good one or a bad one, was on me. I think coming into a leadership position, especially in a situation like that, I can't imagine the role of somebody taking on my role after leaving the House of Dancing Water, me being built it and then being such an institution. What a shitty place to have to start, because, you know, there's a lot of expectation there. So I think, you know, the way that I would approach it is like, okay, I've got to come in and say, what's people's expectation of me? Can I fulfill those? There's two approaches for me. There's the hard and fast, like, cut off a few heads and assert your authority kind of route, or there's sit back and observe and slowly infiltrate your authority through you know, a slow change process. I don't know what the right thing is. I think it comes down to the individual. I have seen people come in and make hard and fast moves, and it's been rocky. I'm not talking about the stage management department. I'm talking about other departments, and people are like shocked and in awe and pissed off, and then 6 months later they've forgotten about it. Sometimes if you come in too soft, you don't ever get that authority. So I just think it's about you reading the situation and reading the people around you and seeing, finding the best way to navigate in terms of that position. Guys, have you walked into a team you've inherited, and how did you experience that?
Yeah, I mean, it can go well, it can go not so well. It's all about expectations on both sides of the coin, you know, and you really have to outline those, I think, from the start. Is that particularly if you're an Australian stage manager working with a stage manager from another country, we all have very different expectations of what the job is in different countries. So outlining what an Australian stage manager expects of the job is very important to, you know, when you're picking up or moving into a department that already has an established stage management team and you're taking the lead of that established team. You really need to listen and open your ears and go, what is it you guys want? What are your expectations? What do you want to get out of this job? Only then can you really understand if you're ever going to get on the right page. You know, some stage managers might have a completely different expectation of the job, and it doesn't align with what you expect from a stage manager at all. So then you can only be honest, you know, and then talk about, look, is this the place that you want to be? Because this is our dynamic now. You know, we're going to not see eye to eye. We're not going to be on the same page. I want it to run this way. You want it to run this way. And never the two will meet. So that's when, you know, you really need to go into a mediation stage and, you know, work out a happy medium and work out if you can work together.
For sure. And I think, like, when walking into a team, it's understanding what your strengths are. And so really kind of like amplifying those as contributions, but then also being very open about where you are on your journey in terms of what you can learn, even if you're walking into a management position, not even just an assistant position, because I think that walking into an environment, it's a two-way street where you're going to be providing a service, you're going to be working for and with that team. However, if you're walking into a management role, you're walking into a team that is now going to be in a way working for you. So it's kind of like, for me, there's two sides to it as well. There's expectations of what the role is and what the job is. And generally that's pretty black and white, and that's pretty fine. But in terms of strengths, sometimes I think strengths tend to come from where our values and ethics are, and kind of bringing those to the table at the beginning as well, and being like, hey, this is what I stand for. This is my style of leadership, or this is what I expect from my leaders. Being really vocal at the beginning and then seeing, okay, is there a resistance here? Is there a rift that we need to mend from the get-go? Is it something we need to work together to navigate, to create something brand new that neither of us are bringing to the table? Or is this something that one of us has been needing that will just gladly adapt to what the other can provide? And as Dean was saying, like, from the get-go, kind of having that in dialogue at the beginning. And you can have those questions about values and ethics on a very very light and social level, which helps us kind of develop really strong interpersonal relationships too, because, you know, we don't just identify each other in terms of what we physically do, but we identify with ourselves in terms of what we think and what we believe, and communicating that to others around us allows them to know who we are for ourselves. And that kind of breaks down a whole bunch of barriers in terms of communication, culture, and all that kind of stuff when we just start to resonate as human beings. So, like, that's a big one when coming into an alien environment. I would say especially, like, stepping up into a management position in a brand new show. Like, there's a whole bunch of challenges there that are completely alien.
Yeah, definitely finding those personal similarities, you know, finding something that you share and using that as the core to then work everything else out around.
Yes, for sure.
For sure.
Speaking a little bit on the other side, because I've spent a lot of my life working under people, and all stage managers are really different. Like, yeah. It's, and I think that's like, you know, it's got to be not underestimated, especially from the stage manager side, like the person that's in charge of the department, is that all stage managers are really different. You know, I've worked on the same show for two different stage managers and I had a completely different experience, you know, because what the, so I think it's really good to be really clear about what your expectations are of the people that are under you, because it can be very confusing if you are that person that's underneath that has always operated in a certain way, and then you have someone come in who expects you automatically to know that they need you to operate in a different way. So I think managing those expectations is really important, but also to have like a level of respect of the people that have been on the show already, and that, you know, like, and obviously there's a reason that they haven't been promoted to that stage manager position. So there's an understanding there that they're either not ready or whatever that is, but at the same time they have a depth of knowledge that you as the stage manager coming in don't necessarily have yet. So it's good to take some time, you know, a little bit of time anyway, to at least understand how it is currently operating and then work out however you want it to operate, but at least to have an idea of what you're coming into and not necessarily come in on the first day and be like, okay, now I need it to run like this. And you're like, hang on a second, we've been running it like this for a year because of this and this reason. Like, you don't have any of the background to know why we're doing it like this. So, but I think, yeah, also as the person who is under, to understand that you need to be flexible, and that, you know, especially if you move from show to show, that each stage manager you work with is going to be slightly different. Like on one show you may have been responsible for this thing, but now that's something that you're not responsible for. And it's good to get as much experience, especially when you're a young stage manager, of working under as many people as possible to get a really good idea of how different stage managers operate, so then you can be as fluid as possible in how you operate, you know, because that's definitely what I've found, especially, you know, like in the last 2 years as a DSM, I've worked under four different stage managers in musical theatre who all operate really differently. So, you know, I go into every situation and I'll always be like, okay, like this is what I've done this piece of paperwork or this training or this rehearsal this way. How do you want it to run? Like what, you know, and sometimes they'll be like, look, I don't actually care. You do whatever you think is best. Or sometimes they'll be like, no, I literally need it to be like A, B, C, D. And you're like, okay, great. I have that framework. But, you know, especially being at house for a long time, it took me a little while. You know, it was interesting going into La Rev after being in house, because it was kind of like going into the same show but not at all. And so I had to be really careful, you know, of not just being like, well, at house we did it like this, you know, and go like, what's the situation here? And, you know, there are definitely things from house that I can use to maybe help like improve some efficiencies here after I've been here for a period of time. But also there's some things that are just the way they are and that's just how they're going to be. So you kind of need to be as flexible as possible, which sounds hilarious, I'm sure, to the people I'm talking to now.
No, but I mean, like, no, I've always said flexibility is the core trait of a stage manager,
especially as you work overseas, man. I mean, the layers of it. Now, I think we should wrap up, but I think Brianna Burgess has given us the perfect question to finish off with. If you could give your past selves a piece of advice, what would it be? So let's just do a round robin give ourselves that, give her that advice, and let's finish up so we don't take up everybody's time. Who wants to start?
Oh, look, I'll start. My biggest piece of advice to me when I first started out would be look after your physical and mental health. Like, it's a very physical industry. You're in it for the long haul. So, you know, make sure that you do look after yourself physically and mentally. And that means taking a break sometimes, because burnout is a really real thing.
Yeah, definitely. I definitely echo that. I did want to start off by saying, you know, the thing that I would say is don't spend so long concentrating on the girls in front of you on the trapeze. Put the cue light on so that you don't completely crash bungee. But
Busby. But Dean is referring to a train wreck that he did at the House of Dancing Water that he goes down in the history as one of the best show calling train wrecks. yeah, in history is just sensational, sensationally bad ending to the show. Funny. Yeah.
But the thing that you learn, the thing that you learn from that is some humility, and you have to learn that what you have to do as a stage manager and anybody in this industry is if you make a mistake, you have to stand up on your chair and go, "That was me. That was me.
Yep.
Sorry. Yeah. Stop the show. Yep. That was me, entirely 100% me." And what happened is Sophie's Duncan's jumped in.
Yeah, super funny.
We called a trapeze queue, and the girls came in front of us on the trapezes as the lifts were going down to adept number one. And then we'd give a green cue light. They would then fall. The lifts keep going down. We give another green cue light for level 4 high dive. They keep going down. Another green cue light for level 8 high dive. Well, I didn't give the green cue light for the trapeze girls to go. So they didn't fall. So everything was then late. And I kept thinking, because I'd made the mistake myself, I was late on a cue light, I can get it back. I can fix this problem. No, and I couldn't. And I just, I kept, okay.
They ran away.
We got to the musical point, the lifts weren't at depth. So I couldn't send that. I canceled level 4 high dive. Then we get to level 8. I can get level 8 high dive back, no problem. Yep. No, I couldn't. The lifts weren't at depth. So we had to cancel that at will. Okay, I can continue with the bows. Let's get the lifts up for bows. I can get that. No, couldn't even get the lifts up for bows. So the cast ran onto stage. No, there's no stage. There's just water. They've kind of like filtered around this like 6-inch beach area, and they're like bowing and running around.
It was so awesome. I wish I had the video. I would totally wish to. So, own your mistakes, what you're saying.
Yeah, that absolutely. It's on you, you know. No one's going, you're going to get in a lot more trouble if you don't own up to your mistakes than if you own up to them.
Well, and also you lose the trust of those around you if you don't own your mistakes, and trust totally is so important. So, yeah, I've definitely been there and gone, yep, 100% me.
Yep, that was me.
Yeah, and it's important.
Mads, Nathan?
Mine would be that someone told me a long time ago, and it's taken, I think, for me to get to a certain age to really appreciate it, but we're not curing cancer. Like, ultimately, we're putting on a show. And I think sometimes the stress of what we're required to do on a daily basis just puts this pressure on you that you put on yourself, and you feel things so intensely. And, like, now having had, I think, like, being a young stage manager that came into Macau and lived that, I think there was so much that I thought was so important that really now I go, it's really not, you know. And it's really like having, as Rex said, like having a life outside, having time for your family and friends, like going to those events, you know, realizing that it's okay to take a night off and to go to a wedding, you know, like this stuff is important. And I think when you're a young stage manager, you live and breathe these shows so much that you think that you're not entitled to a life. And it's really not true. So, like, as much as possible, realize at the end of the day, we're just putting on a show. And it's important what we do, but it's not like, it's not saving someone's life. So don't put that much pressure on yourself and that much pressure on the people around you, you know.
Nice. Nathan?
It's a tricky one for me. I've been thinking, well, people have been talking, there's such nice answers, but I think I kind of always said to myself that when I would come to something that was really challenging that I was afraid of, whether that would be a transition or a change or a new duty at work that was kind of stepping up to the plate kind of thing, and I was kind of a bit scared of those things, like really kind of, just a general kind of fear for bad outcomes or just fear in general of change, I would always kind of say to myself, in 3 weeks, you would have done this already and it would have been fine. So do it as if you've already done it in a way, kind of not as in don't be prepared, always be prepared. But at the same time, don't be afraid. Kind of think about where you are, think about what you've done and project that into the future. And then if you just continue in the same path, being honest and being grounded and being confident and kind of being prepared and doing your research and study, then nothing's really stopping you from achieving everything that you might want to achieve. So just don't be afraid.
I guess my advice to myself would be present, you know, in every single moment, be present. And that comes from years of show calling, very big shows. And I think a lot of the time when I was younger and I'm trying to learn the trade and everything, I was thinking about I should be better and I should know more and I'm not good enough or I'm, you know, I need to work harder and all of those things. And really wisdom comes over many years and layers and compounding of knowledge. And you have to take those lessons each day that you're in the industry and each moment that you're there. And then you may battle with all of the emotions that you have throughout your career can go from, you know, work-life balance, babies, shows, career trajectory, being a woman, sexism, I'm in the Middle East, I'm dealing with this. I mean, you know, and really I try to face each day and being really present. And one of the best examples of that for me is like after calling the House of Dancing Water for, or you know, 7 years, you know, you think that the motivation, you know, does start to wane and how do you stay on it and how do you stay focused? And something that I used to train myself to do after I called Winch Q5, which is the first cue when the garden goes up, I would tell myself silently every show, call this as if it's your last time. And I would go into the show with that energy and I would put all my all in it because I was in that presence of, you know, and who knows when it is our last time, right? So, like, yeah. I call it with that energy and I try to, even in everyday work, whatever I'm doing now, is be present in that moment and take those lessons as they go. So that's really what I would say. So thank you so much for everybody that's joined us. I know a few people have bounced off already because we've been going on for 2 hours and 20 minutes. Thank you so much, guys, for spending time with us. We'd love some feedback. I'm just going to put my email here. So if you want to suggest any other webinars that we should do, Sophie wants the best fail. Best fail shows webinar. We can definitely do between all of us the failure shows because we definitely have a lot of them. And thank you all for joining us. I hope you appreciated the information. And please give us feedback, ideas for other webinars. We're all in downtime right now. So we could probably do this again if you guys want it. Anybody else want to say anything before we go? You guys good?
And I was going to say, all my fails involve Sophie Duncan, so big shout-out.
All right, guys, stay on the line. We'll just go off air. We'll chat for a second. Everybody else who joined us, thank you so much, and we'll talk to you soon.